Start breaking out. I have the authority. Hey, we're going to continue our time of worship through our giving. Here at Pearl Street, we have three ways for you to do so. The first is we have our website, pearlstreet.church. Just go there, click on the Give tab, and you'll be able to give that way. Second is we have our Pearl Street app. Just download that from the App Store, and you can get that set up. And the third way, and my personal favorite way to give, is text to give. Just text one word, PS Give, to 43506. But while you're getting that ready and set up, I want to share an incredible story and something amazing that God is doing here at Pearl Street Church. If you don't know, which you should, every Tuesday night we have something called Talk It Out Tuesday happening 6:30 p.m. live on Zoom. And it's literally a night where we get to come together, hear from our pastor, hear from our leaders in the church, but also there's a time of prayer where we get to lift each other up in prayer and send in prayer requests. And one request in particular that I want to highlight from this past Tuesday is we had somebody, you know, hop into the chat and ask for prayer because they were having a test the next day, specifically a mammogram test, because a doctor found a lump in her chest and she was starting to have fear. And so she said, "Hey, church family, I need prayer in this. I'm a little scared, a little fearful. Can you just please pray for me that, you know, the test comes back negative?" And so that's exactly what we did in that moment. You know, the Bible says, "Where two or three gathered in my name, there I am." And God definitely showed up in that moment on Tuesday night. And so, you know, we prayed with her, we prayed for her, and, you know, she went to go take the test the next day. She went to the doctor, got the mammogram test. And the amazing part of this whole story is that she came back and she reached out to us and said, "Hey, got the test taken, and the doctor said that I am negative." Man, isn't that amazing to hear stories like that? You know, there's tons of life stories and life transformation happening within the church, but it's so cool to see, you know, when we're praying for something, God literally answers a prayer. And that was, in that moment, one of those instances where we pray for someone, and literally the next day, God answered that prayer. And what I love about this story is that this story is not about one or two people within the church, right? It's about all of us coming together. God has given each of us resources in the form of time, talent, and treasure. And in this instance, we get to give our talent, our treasure back to God, back to the house, to say, "You know what, God? I know that this treasure that I'm giving back, God, you're going to take this treasure and continue to transform lives and see life change within Pearl Street Church." And that's literally what's happening on Tuesday nights. You know, we get to create this atmosphere and this environment where people get to come in and feel welcomed and feel engaged because of the resources that you're giving. So thank you so much for all the obedient givers out there that are believing in what God is doing and the mission and the vision of Pearl Street Church. Well, hey, if you're ready here today, let's go ahead and pray for your giving. God, thank you so much for what you're doing here at Pearl Street Church. Thank you, Father, that we have obedient givers in the house that believe in the mission and in the vision of Pearl Street Church. Father, thank you for people that get to come in and we get in the stories that we get to hear, God, of life transformation each and every week, God. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
So good to see you. What a great day to be alive, expectant for an incredible future that God has for you and me. Wherever you are, you're in the best place right now because you're tuned in, ready to jump into God's word. Now, we've been looking at, over the past couple months, the book of Acts, how crazy it is and how amazing it is that, man, Jesus died, raised to life, sent the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has filled up believers. Believers are on the move, facing every obstacle and not backing down. You know, one of the thoughts I have for maybe today's message, I didn't title it this, but it could have been this, but kicked out, but not knocked down, man. It just seemed like everywhere that Paul was going, he was kicked out of a city, but he was not knocked down. Was not knocked down. Kicked out, but not knocked down. How about, we're just going to name the title. That's the title. We're going to do it. We're going to do that here today. If you want a second title, you can put it as this. Passion on point. But kicked out, but not knocked down, or passion on point. Your choice. You get to choose today. Whatever you want the title to be. But we find in here that Paul, empowered by the Holy Spirit, leading believers, other disciples, him and Barnabas specifically, sent out by the church to go and preach to Gentiles, went on their first missionary journey and had some incredible success, went and reported it back to Jerusalem and all the incredible things God was doing. The church is excited. There's a lot of passion around Jesus Christ and the message of the gospel that's happening right now. And with this, Paul is on a second missionary journey now. And we looked at this last week. And as they were going through these different towns, the past 2 weeks we've been looking at on their second missionary journey, him and Silas have gone out and Timothy's along for the journey. Luke is along for the journey. So four of these guys are rolling. They've already dropped off Luke at the church in Philippi to encourage Lydia and the demon-possessed girl and the jailer there. And now he's cruising with Silas and Timothy, both these guys. And they head into this town. And this is kind of where we start off today, where they head into this town. And the theme is roughly the same. Paul, along with the guys traveling with them, when they head into a town, they do the same thing every time. They go to where the Jewish believers are. Where is there already a foundation of believers in the God of all creation that are following the Jewish faith so they can come in and encourage them about the Christ, the Messiah that has been born that maybe they've heard about but don't have a full understanding of, that now they can come in and encourage them. Let's talk about Old Testament, and then let's speak about Christ, who he was, and what he did, right? And so that is what they were doing. They would go in, and they would go to the Jewish place, and they would speak around this passion they had for the message of Jesus Christ. Have you ever had a moment in your life where somebody was so passionate about something that that is all they talked about? So passionate about it. Like maybe it was just a mom that just had a baby and it's, oh my God, my baby and this and that thing. They just started doing this and they burped up. Man, they're so cute, blah, blah, blah. And every story, everything, they're passionate about it, right? Maybe it's around something they're involved with that moment in time. I mean, I think we have moments in time of extreme passion inside of our lives where we dive in on things and we're passionate about maybe the end result. We're doing a lot of research around something. Maybe it's health, it's fitness, maybe it's career, maybe it's your money, maybe it's your parenting, whatever it is. We get wrapped into these things like, we got to tell you about this, whoa, you know, and we want to share it. People can get really passionate about things in which they love and the outcomes in which they want to see happen. You know, the beautiful thing is that Paul is passionate about Jesus Christ. And as they are on this journey and on this missionary journey, the second one, they're going in there passionately speaking about Jesus Christ. So we'll pick up the story here in Acts 17. And I think it's, you know, there's a theme that's popping out here. And I want to talk to it just for a second, because I think maybe it would suit us in this season of life for us to be careful not to get caught up. So it says here in Acts 17, verse number 1, Paul and Silas then traveled through the towns of Amphipolis and Apollonia and came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As was Paul's custom, he went to the synagogue service, and for 3 Sabbaths in a row, he used the scriptures. So 3 weeks in a row, he used the scriptures to reason with the people. So basically to start a dialogue. The reason that is pointed out here, the reason is he would start a dialogue. Let's start a dialogue. Let's talk about the Old Testament. That's a Jewish synagogue. They're reading out of the Torah. And Paul's just opening up dialogue about the Old Testament and what God is speaking through the Old Testament. So he does this for 3 weeks. Opening up, talking about scriptures. It says in verse number 3, he explained the prophecies and proved that the Messiah must suffer and rise from the dead. He said, this Jesus I'm telling you about is the Messiah. So he's bringing into the conversation a conversation about Jesus. We're talking about Old Testament. Let's have a dialogue. Now he's talking about Jesus, who Jesus was, who the Christ must, you know, who what Christ must do. He must die and be raised to life. And then he's talking all these prophecies out, and then he proved to them that the Messiah must suffer and do all this. And it says the Jesus that I'm telling you about is the Messiah, the guy that I'm saying, all these prophecies, it is Jesus. He is the Messiah. Verse number 4, some of the Jews who listened were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas along with many God-fearing Greek men and quite a few prominent women. So you have prominent people that are coming to faith and believing that, man, Jesus was the promised Messiah from the Old Testament. And through this testimony of Paul that he did die and he was raised alive, and he is the way, the truth, and the life. Now there's this understanding that's there now, and they're coming into this place to believe. So these the Greeks inside of here, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago, the churches, this Jewish synagogue is not just made up of Jewish individuals. There's Greek individuals that would be called God-fearing men or women. They believe in the Almighty God. They believe that he is the creator of the universe. They believe that he has given his word through the Torah. They believe in all of that, but they've come short of completely stepping into all of the Jewish practices. And so these individuals that are there, a part of this, are hearing it, they're believing, okay? Now here's where it gets interesting, and I want to point this out here, but some of the Jews were jealous. So they gathered some troublemakers from the marketplace to form a mob and start a riot. They attacked the home of Jason, searching for Paul and Silas so that they could drag them out to the crowd. Not finding them there, they dragged out Jason and some of the other believers instead and took them before the city council. Paul and Silas have caused, this is their decree here, Paul and Silas has caused trouble all over the world, they shouted, and now they are here disturbing our city too. And Jason has welcomed them into his home. They are all guilty of treason against Caesar, for they profess allegiance to another king named Jesus. This passion that they have, stoked out of their minds about Jesus and the gospel, they're doing what is accustomed. They're stepping into the realm where people already have a belief in God, and they're speaking the truth, the good news about Jesus Christ. And these Jewish individuals inside of here were jealous. It's not the first time we've seen it. Jealousy has happened in multiple other cities, as we've read about over the past couple of weeks, Iconium, Lystra, these other places that they've gone to. And with that, these Jewish leaders have thrown, you know, brought false accusations against them, brought harm against them. And it all stems from this place of jealousy, this place where individuals are looking at Paul, Silas, Timothy, maybe Mark, and saying, man, look at what they're able to do. Look at, you know, the wisdom in which they have. Look at their ability to eloquently speak about the Old Testament and then the Messiah and the work of Jesus and what he has done and, you know, how he received salvation. And they're looking at this because all they've ever known is the Jewish law. That's all they've ever known is the Messianic, you know, faith. That's all they've ever known. They've only known the Jewish faith. And for them, not the Messianic faith. They only known the Jewish faith. That's all they've ever known. And now all of a sudden they're coming in and you got the Paul and Silas that are talking about, man, a new way. There's a new understanding that what the Old Testament spoke about has actually come to a reality, and God has provided a way for salvation. And through this, it's changing the world of these individuals. And through jealousy, these individuals now are coming against Paul and Silas and Luke and also Timothy, these individuals. You know, one of the things that I just want to point out here today is jealousy, this jealous spirit on the inside of him. What we know, it's a sinful nature harbors a jealous spirit. You know, in the season that we are in here today, where it seems like everything's on hold and seems like there's a lot of lack or there's a lot of setbacks in this season. Maybe there's a lot of loss in this season. It's very easy in this season where it looks like things are not going well, maybe for us specifically or just in general, it doesn't look like things are going well. It's very easy to get caught in a place where we look at the world and say, ah, man. And we have a negativity, and maybe this little sin wants to creep in on jealousy, where we begin to look at somebody else and what they have, or at least the appearance of what they have, and we begin to desire what they have. And we find ourselves in a place where this jealousy leads to a place inside of our life where it robs us of the motivation that we need to accomplish all that God has for us inside of our lives. And we begin to look out and like, oh, well, they just are so lucky and I don't have that. What does it do? It jealousy just puts us in a place where we overlook all of God's blessing in our lives, and then we overemphasize everybody else's what appears to be blessing in their lives. Jealousy just robs us. Jealousy allows anger to turn into resentment, and resentment to turn into hate, and this hate to overwhelm God's calling for us to live a life of love. This jealousy drives us to act out of alignment with righteousness, out of alignment with righteousness. You know, jealousy is driving these individuals towards very negative places, very negative actions. And, you know, I think it's something to be said here today, and just want to pull it out. Number one, if you want to write it down, enjoy your position today. Enjoy your position, but determine to change your future. If you're here today, and maybe this is a time for you to take self-inventory, and you've slowed down, and you're looking at your life, and you are looking at the world, you're frustrated with where you're at. You know, you're frustrated at what maybe has been lost. You're frustrated at what you see inside of the world. And here today, you're wanting to move towards jealousy on what everybody else has. What I'd say is just pull back. Come to a clear understanding. Operate from the gifts of the Holy Spirit, man. Allow your life. When we're led by the Holy Spirit, the outworking of these things is righteousness. Love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. It's the outworking of the Holy Spirit's leading that leads us to this place. So we got to enjoy our position. Thank God for where we are at. Celebrate all the blessings that he's provided inside of our lives. But if we desire more than where we are at, cool. Celebrate where you're at. Enjoy the position you're in, but determine that you're going to change your future. And with that, then you can take self-responsibility and say, I'm not where I want to be in my marriage. I'm not where I want to be in my relationship with my kids. I'm not where I want to be inside of my career. I'm not where I want to be financially. I'm not where I want to be today inside of my housing. I desire to own a house or, you know, X, Y, and Z. If you are in a place where you desire more, don't allow the door to be opened with jealousy that will lead you down a place where you'll be completely out of alignment with the truth of God's word and the righteousness that God has called you to lead in. If you lead yourself, you go down a road, a place of resentment and anger and hate towards another individual, and that just completely overwhelms the love on the inside of your life, it's gonna be really hard. That's the doorway of the devil to come in and just overwhelm your heart with frustration and anger towards the world at large, because you don't feel like you are blessed, or you don't feel like you have what everybody else has. These Jewish individuals, out of jealousy, are bringing false accusations. And in this season, we got to be really careful that we don't allow ourselves in a jealous eye to step in. On this journey in life, what is the reality? As we live a blessed life, there is going to be false accusations that come against us. But the beautiful thing is that in life, and I love this, and I quoted it the other night on Talk It Out Tuesday. And you got to jump in on Talk It Out Tuesday. It's incredible what's going on. I love that time. But Aristotle would say, it's impossible to avoid criticism, right? He says, the only way to avoid criticism is to say nothing, do nothing, and be nothing. At the end of the day, when you live a life of purpose, you live a life on point, right? Passion on point for the calling that God has inside of your life. When you live from that premise, get ready for jealous individuals, the sin nature to come out of individuals of this world to try to hinder what God is trying to do through you. Got to be really careful you don't get caught in the fringes of the chaos of sin as you are living a life of purpose on mission with the God's calling in your life. So keep on plugging away. Seek, be encouraged with where you're at. Enjoy where you're at, your position of where you're at. And if you're not happy, determine to change your future. The second thing I'll leave you with is seek truth in the truth to stay clear of the lies. Seek truth in the truth to stay clear of the lies. You know, Paul and Silas were brought, false accusations thrown against them. These individuals, these Jewish individuals, couldn't find them. They grab Jason and a few other believers, throw them in prison, make them post bond, get them out of prison. From there, Paul and Silas are sent out of the city, and they go from Thessalonica into Berea, a different town about 40 miles away. And they step into this place, and the same thing goes on. You find where Paul and Silas, they would go into Berea, and it says this in Acts 17, and I'll pick up the conversation in verse number 10. It says, that very night, the believers sent Paul and Silas to Berea. When they arrived there, they went to the Jewish synagogue, and the people of Berea were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica, there we go, and they listened eagerly to Paul's message. They searched the scriptures day after day to see if Paul and Silas were teaching the truth. As a result, many Jews believed, as did many of the prominent Greek women and men and women. Verse 13, but when some Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God in Berea, they went there and stirred up trouble. The believers acted at once, sending Paul onto the coast, but while Silas and Timothy remained behind, those escorted Paul, went with him all the way to Athens. Then they returned to Berea with instructions for Silas and Timothy to hurry and join him. We're going to talk about Athens next week. But what you find inside of here is Paul and Silas step into Berea. They're doing the same thing. They come in to have a conversation. They begin to talk about Jesus, do the same thing that they would do in town to town and town to town. The beautiful thing that happens inside of here, and I love what it says, is that the church inside of Berea, it says that they listened eagerly to Paul's message. Then it says they searched the scriptures day after day to see if Paul and Silas were teaching the truth. As a result, many Jews believed, as did many of the prominent Greek women, men and women. Okay? These individuals, the church in Berea, said, okay, we're listening to Paul and Silas. They're preaching, they're teaching, they're giving us some new ideas, and guess what we're going to do? We're hearing new concepts. What are we going to do? We're going to go to the truth. We're going to go to the truth to vet their truth. What are they saying? What is their truth? Let me take it to my truth, and so I can come to an understanding on, is what they are saying true? Now, I'll tell you, the beautiful thing about Berea is they understand. They got it on point. They know what's up. They're like, cool, you can come in here, say whatever you want to say, do whatever you want to do, but guess what we're going to do? We're going to take it to the truth to vet if your truth is actually the truth, if what you are speaking is true. And I tell you, this is what truth should be right here. This is the truth. You know, I hope that as I'm speaking here today, you're doing research. You're like, man, is this in alignment? Is this on point, man? Is this the truth? I hope you are. Man, there's times where I may err in my judgment of what scripture says, but know my heart is 100% genuine, and I'm trying to communicate the gospel, the truth about Jesus Christ. I'm trying to passionately display the principles that God has destined for us to live by. And I'm trying to distill them down to empower us as much as we can. My heart is in the most purest place, but I may err sometimes in my evaluation of scripture and its intent. And that's okay. You know, it's okay for us to have a good conversation, but the premise of their life is, and I love this, and this is how you and I should be as believers, as a church of Jesus Christ. In a world, the information generation, more information is being shared across the globe right now than ever in history. We have more access to information than ever in history right now. In this information age in which we live in, where there is everybody has a platform, social media, everybody has a voice. Anybody can say anything at any moment in time. In this information age, we have to seek the truth in the truth of God's word so that we can stay clear of lies. We got to be very careful. This church in Berea, they're hearing it, We're taking it to the truth. Okay, cool. We vetted it. He's cool. It's truth. I'll tell you today, we got to be very careful in this day and age that we don't fall victim to the lie of information that's trying to take us to a place of believing that drives a certain action out of us. And it's all derived from a different philosophy. It's derived from a completely different worldview than a Christian worldview. Completely different. I'm reading a book right now called Trust Me, I'm Lying. It's all about mainstream media and their ability to change and manipulate and adjust narratives in order to get the person watching to believe a specific narrative. It's incredible. A guy that was in the industry, and the whole thing is pretty interesting on how it goes down. But true journalism is dead in our country today, and that is unfortunate. So what do we have to do as believers? We got to be truth seekers. We got to seek the truth in all that we hear. We got to hear it. Cool. Now, what does God's word say? We got to go do our research. Cool. What does God's word say about this? How should we live? How should we act? How should we respond? We should be individuals that go to our truth as we are looking at the world that's trying to communicate a truth to us. I love the church in Berea that, man, they're seeking truth in the truth so that they can stay clear of a lie. The better you know the truth, the quicker you'll point out a lie. The more you walk in the truth, the easier it is to steer clear your life from the lie. The more you know the truth about God and his plan for humanity and the demise of the enemy for humanity, sin entering into the world, the easier it is to point out individuals that operate with a completely different motive than the truth of God's word. Seek the truth in the truth to stay clear of the lies. Let's be people that know the truth, live the truth, and stay clear of the lies. Amen. The church in Berea was legit. Now, the last part of here, I'll point out number three, and I'll end with this, is you can write this down. Number three, passion on point draws people. When passion is on point, it will draw people. Right. As I said on the front end of here, passionate people about a restaurant will draw people to go eat at that restaurant. Passionate people about a specific dress or a clothing will draw people to go, you know, maybe buy that shirt or that brand or whatever it may. Passionate people about a specific vehicle and its ability may draw people towards that product. Right. Passion draws people. It draws people. And what you find with Paul and Silas is they are passionate about the gospel. And as they are passionate about the gospel, they are stepping into cities and turning these things upside down. They're turning these cities upside down. Be basically, you can find in Acts 17, verse number 3, where these individuals, these Jewish individuals that I read about on the first part in the church in Thessalonica, these individuals, it says, he explained the prophecies and proved that the Messiah must suffer and rise from the dead. He said, this Jesus I'm telling you about is the Messiah. Some of the Jews who listened were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas along with many God-fearing Greek men and women. Their passion for the truth about Jesus Christ was leading people. It was drawing people towards Jesus. Their passion was drawing people towards Jesus. When we are passionate about Jesus, it draws people to Jesus. When we are passionate about what Jesus has done inside of our lives, it will draw people to Jesus. It draws people. Paul and Silas are there. They're passionately communicating the truth of God's word. And man, people are being drawn city after city, life after life. Now, to distinguish the difference between a Paul going into a world and, you know, you think about Thessalonica, you think about Berea. These are two different churches, two different synagogues, two different places that clearly already had 10 families inside of these cities that they would even be able to establish a synagogue. So they're established places that already have a predisposition, an understanding of God Almighty. They're just bringing the extra on top of it where prophecies are being fulfilled through Jesus Christ. And they're adding into it to bring, you know, connect the dots for Jewish believers believers at that moment in time that the Messiah has come, he's lived in, and he's died, and he's died for their sins, and now we need a Savior, and it's pointed out in the Old Testament, now he is alive, and blah, all of that. They're doing all of that. And sometimes we can get so like, well, what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to like go town to town and do the whole bit? No, that's not what you're supposed to do. But we are supposed to be light into a broken world. We are supposed to be passionate about our faith. We are supposed to be seeking opportunity to share our faith wherever we may go with whoever we get the opportunity to share it with. We're living in a world that desperately needs Jesus Christ. You look at all the uproar today that people are wanting change. Change, 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 change. We want change and all. We want to see change and you know, the minority of people that is doing all of that, right? That's the minority of people inside of our country that doing that. But ultimately, what they desperately need is they need Jesus. They desperately need Jesus because he is the transformation that's going to turn this upside down. It's going to turn, you know, the wrongs into rights and the wrong motives into right motives. He's the transformation on the inside of our sinful nature and our sinful hearts as humanity that will turn us back towards God into a place of alignment with righteousness and living in love. He is the person that's going to do that. And all of this uproar, man, what they're really saying without saying it is, man, we need Jesus. We need Jesus. That's what we need. We need Jesus. Paul is there. Man, Paul and Silas, people are being drawn towards Christ, towards Jesus. Their passion is on point, and it's drawing people. Is your passion on point here today that is drawing people? Let's be clear. They are evangelists. They're going out. But just as much as they are going out, you are living today. And if you're passionate about Jesus, you're passionate about what God is doing, it's going to draw people. Just set your expectations properly. 1, 2, 3 people that, man, you're able to passionately share Jesus with. You're doing what Jesus has called you to do on your journey in life, helping people find Jesus. You know, Paul would speak in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and basically, he talks about this right here, the hope in the gospel into a dark world. And for us, he does it very well. And I'm going to let him preach it here as I just say it. And it's such an encouraging message for us to hear is that as we live this and we speak this, you know, you think about Paul is saying, like, we're here to preach Jesus, who he is and what he did, who he is, what he did. Who he is, what he did. They did this in every single city. It may seem redundant to us, but it was not redundant in that moment in time because every city they stepped into, it was new information. And the beautiful thing is we get to do the exact same thing. Paul would say in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it says, the message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. Speaking to this to the church in Corinth. He says, as the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. Verse number 20. So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish, since God in his wisdom saw it that the world would never know him. Through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs of heaven from heaven. It is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended, and the Gentiles say, it's all nonsense. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles alike, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans. And God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. Remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes or powerful or wealthy when God called you. Instead, God chose things that the world considered foolish in order to shame those who think they are wise. And he chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful. God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. As a result, no one can ever boast in the presence of God. What is this saying here? This message about Jesus is foolish to people who think themselves wise. God's plan is insanely wise. He is stronger. He is wiser than man and our human reasoning, the world in which we live in our humanistic ideas. Let's push them down on any type of religious dogma. We are the highest form of truth. And Paul is specifically saying here to the church in Corinth that God is wiser than all of that. And his plan is foolish to those that think themselves wise. And what is he saying? God has used us, the powerless, to bring down the powerful. God has used us to bring down the world's humanistic ideas. And for us living in the truth, walking in the truth, passionately speaking the truth, there's going to be people that think it's foolish, but praise God, we know what the truth is. God has revealed it to us. We have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and we can't get down when the world around us is trying to say we are foolish. Man, through our lives, our passionate lives, we can be a witness. We can show, man, through our power. You know, we may be powerless, but we can bring down the powerful, man. God can use us, right? Maybe think us foolish to bring down the wise, all of that. God can use us. I love what it says here in verse number 30. I'll read 30 and 31. God has united you with Christ Jesus. For our benefit, God made him to be wisdom itself. Christ made us right with God. Christ made us right with God. He made us pure and holy, and he freed us from sin. Therefore, as the scriptures say, if you want to boast, boast only about the Lord. That's it. What is it? We get a life to live where we can passionately preach about Jesus, live a life to talk about all that Jesus has done, who he is, what he has done for us, how he's changed our lives. We get to do this over and over and over, continually leading a passionate life. And I'll tell you today, if we are lacking passion, man, just get into God's word. The Holy Spirit can teach and train you. The Holy Spirit will lead you towards the truth of God's word. You can get jazzed up again, step out and lead a life of passion that can draw people to Christ. And here today, in all of this life that we are living, we can bring down all these crazy arguments or humanistic ideas, and we can bring them all down simply by leading a life of righteousness. And we can't boast about it because this is what Christ has done, right? If we live from a place of humility, just say, man, God has done it all, but we're passionately going to keep on living. No one can boast about that. If we're going to boast about anything, let's just be people that boast in the Lord, as it says here. This is the message of the gospel. It is so good. When passion is on point, it draws people. Let's be a church that is passion is on point about Jesus Christ. We may be kicked out of here, kicked out of there, but we are not knocked down, right? We may get kicked in the side, kicked out, but we're not knocked down, right? We're in a place where we're going to continue just living as Paul and Silas did and all the disciples did, the Acts 2 church filled up by the Holy Spirit. We're going to keep on pressing forward in the face of all obstacles, all opposition, whether it's intellectual, whether it's physical, whatever it may be. We're going to keep on being the light into a broken world because we know our life brings down those that think themselves wise, those that, you know, in this world that are focused on the wrong things, that what they think is important. We bring the real important things up. And those that find themselves powerful, he's going to use the powerless to bring those people down. Let's be children of the light as we follow Jesus. Man, I pray this week, if you're not passionate, you've lost that passion, your passion isn't on point. Maybe you have been kicked out and you're knocked down. Now it's time to get back up so you can keep on moving. But let's be people. Passion is on point. We may get kicked, but we are not knocked down. In Jesus' name, let's worship.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failure, carry the cross for my shame, my sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. What could I say? What could I do but to offer this heart, oh God, completely to you? So I'll walk upon salvation, your spirit life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what could I say? What could I do but to offer this heart, oh God, could I say? What could I do but to offer this heart, oh God, completely to you, completely. Arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, you surrendered all. I am is yours, all I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one.
It was so good to have you tuned in right here today for this message. I pray that you are encouraged and you are strengthened inside of your faith. Man, you are confident here today in accomplishing what God has laid out for you to do as a believer, whatever sphere of influence that you are in. I pray that you are ready
to get it done. Now, our kids' experience is coming up next. Make sure you jump online, get your kids around. They'll be encouraged to get ready for their week. Outside of that, keep on making a difference in the world in which God has destined you to lead in. Have a great week.